by considering, you know, I would repeat the argument. Today, I want to address a totally different kind of question, whether there are new phases of matter that have no free fermion description that are nevertheless SPT phases. Okay? You know, so we already know that the Haldane spin chain gives an example of such a phase, but clearly we want to know whether there are new ones that are even beyond the topological insulator and the Haldane spin chain. So the strategy that the field has followed, and which is the view here, is to first study SPT phases of bosons or spin systems. In many body physics, people often interchange the word boson versus spin, even though microscopically they are very different. Because if you have a spin model, where you have a lattice system of quantum spins interacting with each other in some way, from a long distance point of view, the spins at different sites commute, right? Just like boson operators. And so we tend to think of spin systems as boson systems, right? The absorbed spin systems into the general framework of interacting boson systems. On site, spins don't satisfy the standard boson communication relation. But, you know, that's really short distance, high energy physics, right? Which doesn't matter for these purposes. So, distinguished co-organizers here, we work from cold atoms, bosons. Most of the rest of us in this room, actually that may not even be true. You know, a lot of charismatic physicists work on electronic solids, so you can ask, why should you study bosons first? Right? So there's some good reasons to study bosons in this quest to understand interacting SPT phases. The first is that, it's sort of a good challenge to start with. Because for bosons, you don't have the crutch for non-trivial non-interacting limit. You know, non-interacting bosons, they only know how to do one thing, which is to bose condense. Okay? So if you want a gap phase of bosons, you necessarily must deal with an interacting theory right from the first step. Okay? You can't throw interactions out and incorporate it as an afterthought. Okay? So thinking about bosons will force us to think about KI phases without the crutch of band structure. That's a good reason to start with bosons. But then in general, in correlated many-body physics, we know that correlated bosons are a lot easier to deal with than correlated fermions. For instance, the fermionic Hubbard model is something that's very poorly understood in two or three dimensions, but the bosonic Hubbard model is completely true if we just understand everything. So it's a lot easier to understand bosons than it is to understand fermions, and we'll be forced to understand it without having the crutch of band structure. Right? So these are very good reasons to study bosons. And there's natural realizations and spin systems and cold atom systems and so on. What a good motivation. So there's been a tremendous amount of formal progress in understanding these bosonic SPT phases. And I already mentioned my review, but there's an earlier review reviewing what was known at that time by Turner, which also you might read with benefit. So I'm not going to go through all of this, and really one of the pioneers of this field is, I was going to point my laser at him, but he said it first, is sitting right up there. So in 1D, it turns out there's a very complete understanding of the various possible SPT phases and their classification, physical properties, and so on. In higher dimensions, there's been, again, tremendous progress just in the last few years. Much of it is through very formal methods. For instance, the seminal paper in this field is by Jiechen, Jiechen Gu, Jingqing Liu, and Shougang Wen. It's a really formidable paper. It introduces this concept of group cohomology to describe and classify these spaces. I won't tell you what it is because I don't know what cohomology is. So, the thing that I would like to emphasize in these lectures is that it's possible, despite the seemingly formidable complexity of some of the papers in this field, it's possible to understand a great deal and make real progress using very simple physical ideas. Right? So what I want to do is to illustrate the physics of these bosonic spin-to-phases with two examples, at least one example and maybe two at this time, one in two dimensions and one in three dimensions. In 1D, we already know the Hordane spin change, so I'm not going to develop that further. But let me give you a simple example in two dimensions and another simple example in three dimensions. Okay? Yeah?
So for the non-interacting boson, is it now
possible to
have a
simple boson
and
a simple boson,
and is it possible to have some
emergence? Right, so that's a great question, and the answer is yes. You can certainly have, in terms of single particle physics, the four-non band structure, it certainly as a matter of principle possible to have non-trivial four-non band structure, which has edge modes and so on, but they're not occupied in a ground state. Right? So those are, single particle excited states. Right? And same is true for photons, and one of my colleagues, in fact, has spent a lot of time realizing topological band structures of photons. The magnons and so on, but all of those are properties of the excitation, so the excitation spectrum, rather than of the many-body ground state. So if you have a finite density of bosons, non-interacting, doing something, they'll lose the mix. They just don't know how to do anything else. The fermions can do more things, they can form an insulator, they can form a metal, whatever. Right. But nevertheless, in the ground state, it will form, if there's no interaction, it will pick some condensation pattern. Okay? There may be more than one pattern. Okay. So I'm going to talk about a very simple example. In two dimensions, I'm going to talk about an integer from Hall state of bosons. Okay. So this question is actually, if you think about it, interesting. For fermions, we all know that there's an integer from Hall effect on a magnetic field in two dimensions. And the way we think about the integer from Hall effect is that you solve the non-interacting problem, form lambda levels, and then you fill lambda levels, and the density of fermions is such that you fill an integer number of lambda levels, you get an integer from Hall effect. Okay? Now for bosons, we can pose the following question. Can bosons show an integer from Hall effect? Okay? Now clearly this picture of filling lambda levels has to be thrown off. Right? Because for bosons, you don't fill levels. Right? That's just the wrong language to talk about bosons. Okay? If you just start with the non-interacting problem, the bosons at some filling in the lambda level will have they'll be in a highly degenerate many-body state, right? And then it's up to interactions to lift the degeneracy. Pretty much like what for electrons we have to deal with in the fraction of one form. For bosons at any filling, you have to deal with the lambda level degeneracy, the many-body degeneracy of a many-body state in the lambda level. Has to be split by interactions. So interactions is, king for bosons in a strong magnetic field. So the first question that we have to define is what should we really mean by the integer quantum Hall state, right, for bosons? So let's think about the integer quantum Hall state for fermions. It's a state that sigma x y equals in t. Right? That's the zeroth order definition. But actually, we know a little bit more than that. We know a hell of a lot more than that. We know that this the excitations in the bulk, unlike in the fractional quantum Hall effect, the bulk excitations are just electrons. They're not anions or charged one-third object, they're just ordinary electrons. Right? So we'll demand the same thing of this integer quantum Hall state of bosons. We'll demand that sigma xy be an integer, and we'll demand that the bulk has no fractional statistics for the particles, but nevertheless, no fractional charge, but nevertheless has an integer quantized all conductance. Okay? Can such a state of matter exist? Okay. So the answer to this is yes, and it turns out to be a very physical, very simple example of a symmetry protected topological phase in two dimensions. Okay. So let me describe a model for this phenomenon. So let's take a system of two species of bosons, two component bosons, moving in a strong magnetic field, such that each species is at filling factor 2 equals 1. So let me remind you that the filling factor is is 2 pi times the density, is the density of electrons divided by the density of flipped quantum. Sorry, density of particles divided by the density of flipped quantum. In this case, particles and bosons. But I'm going to have two species, and each species will be a filling factor 1. Right? Meaning, each species, the density is precisely equal to the density of external flipped quantum. Okay? So the Hamiltonian will have two terms. The first is the usual term, kinetic energy in the magnetic field, it's a chemical potential. And the second will be some generic sort of two-body repulsion, which may include both interspecies repulsion and intraspecies repulsion. Okay. In fact, the simplest model will replace the VAJ by just a delta function. And it turns out that we know that just a delta function repulsion is actually enough to stabilize the space, the phase that we're going to talk about. Okay. So this rho is V dagger I, V I, it's the density of species I, and I range from 1 to 2. Doesn't matter, but two component gives me the easiest access to the physics. I can give you a physical, a reason, a posteriori reason, but yeah.
And charged bosons both condense?
Charged bosons can both condense, sure. Why not?
How do you know?
Sorry?
How do you know?
Supercondense. Supercondense.
I see, that uses Fermi statistics to make the main body state.
Oh, but no energy is in the long distance physics, it doesn't matter, it's more by condensation.
So you would say if we had a Bose metal, it would turn into a Bose superconductor?
If you had a Bose metal, it depends. I mean, Bose metals are weird shapes of matter.
That's why I'm asking you this question.
Right. So, there are some kinds of Bose metals. We have to know what we're talking about, because unlike a Fermi liquid, when you say Bose metal, you have
But this is a Bose.
No, not yet. This is going to be an insulator. It's a quantum model. At the end of the day, we'll see that it's a quantum model.
If the vector potential was zero, what state would it be?
Then there's no boson, so I don't have to. You have zero chemical potential in this system, there'll be no bosons.
It's a vector.
Sorry?
It's a vector potential.
Oh, sorry, vector potential. It'll just be a super flow.
It would be what?
A super flow.
That's what I said. Assume that a boson is super. So
right.
We don't know whether that state can exist.
We certainly know that state can exist, and besides, I'm talking about short range contactions for Coulomb.
How do we know that state can exist?
That boson with short range repulsion, that finite density form a super third?
Yes.
Helium 4.
No, charge.
No, but there's no long range Coulomb contactions.
So what charge connects to that vector potential if there's no long-range interaction between the particles?
There's a model, right? It's certainly consistent to take my non-relativistic boson and add vector potential here. Right? Now, the fact that the electromagnetic field also involves a coupling, that there's an A0 component, it plays no role in any of this discussion. After all, if you take the Hubbard model of electrons in a magnetic field, it's a standard practice to ignore the long-range Coulomb interaction and just write down the short-range model in a magnetic field. That's only a consistent theoretical model. Right? Now, in practice, in a cold atom setting, for instance, people are talking about quantum Hall phenomenon and cold atoms. Right? There's no long-range Coulomb interaction.
No, I completely agree with that, but these are charged objects. I'm a bit skeptical that they can actually both predict.
Just
make a model based statement, and within the model, having charge means that you're charged under a vector potential.
Yeah.
And what kind of interaction that vector potential mediate depends on the action for the vector potential itself.
Well, if the vector potential was zero, you have charged bosons. The hypothesis is that they can both
convince.
Okay, I'd like to know whether that's true.
Right, so I can answer this question at many levels. First of all,
one of the theories.
Right. So let me address all these questions.
Okay.
So first of all, if I just take in the continuum, bosons that interact with each other through Coulomb attraction, one over all Coulomb attractions, right? In two dimensions or in three dimensions, that the translation varies. You know, there's two fates for such a boson system. They can either both condense and form a charged superfluid, or it can crystallize and form a solid. Right? And that's true whether or not we have long range Coulomb attraction. Right? The long range Coulomb attraction will have some effects like change the penetration depth to be finite and so on. But it doesn't really change the essential feature. That is a superfluid. Right? A superfluid which becomes a charged superfluid is like a superconductor. It's essentially a superconductor of bosons. Okay? But that is immaterial. That the statement that I just made, though, while true, are sort of immaterial to what I'm going to discuss. What I'm going to discuss specifically is a model that short-range interaction between the bosons. And then I'm coupling these short-range interacting bosons to an external magnetic field within quotes. And what you really should imagine is what Eric probably does every day, which is to, for instance, imagine, I don't think he does this, but his colleagues in the field, imagine introducing external magnetic fields that they're called atoms, which clearly are electrically neutral, that they see, for instance, by rotating the tap. Doesn't really give you very big magnetic fields. Or more recently, you know, people are trying to do all kinds of things on lattices by using fictitious vector potentials that neutral atoms see. Right? And that's a huge effort in the cold atoms community. Right? And so the point there is that it's certainly consistent to take a model with boson number conservation, right? Don't take it as charge, and then take that boson number conservation symmetry and couple in a vector potential that couples the current of this conserved boson number. Right? So that's what's being done here. It's certainly a mathematically consistent thing to do, and the code of atoms context is physically relevant as well. So coming back to your statement, you know, what we don't have relativity here. Right? So magnetic fields don't necessarily, and even dynamic of magnetic fields, you know, don't necessarily imply electric fields. Right, that the system couples to.
Right? There might be some formula. There might be some formula where you take the charge times magnetic field to be constant, but take the charge to zero and the magnetic field to infinity.
No. Don't learn.
If you want some mathematically.
No, I understand very well that you can create something that looks like a vector potential for neutral particles by using the vector potential of the Coriolis force. That's been done for 100 years. That's not surprising.
Yeah.
Those are charged neutral systems which do bose condense. Okay? So whether electrically charged bosons bose condense, in my opinion, is an open question.
No, no, what do you mean by electric charge?
Electric charge is either positive or negative charges as defined by Volta or by Franklin.
Right, but here I'm at finite density, so total boson number is non-zero.
I think Seamus is asking a very interesting question that I don't have anything to do with your mom.
Yes, Seamus, I'd love to talk to you and figure out what you have to have in your mind.
But this is not a model of charged bosons.
He said it was.
Boson number of conservation, quantum number of conservation. It's really, if you wish, two species of helium 4. Sorry? It could be, but usually when Seamus says something, that's something that I would really like to understand. So let's do it offline. Someone here had a question. if you remember, catch me any other time. Alright, with apologies to Seamus, if no one, I was going to call it boson number, but since you provoked me, I'm going to start calling this the boson charge. So. Anyway, so the model should be clear, okay? It's a mathematically well-defined model, and it's probably physically, can be made physically relevant with some tweaking in some cold atoms context. So that's what we'll study. Oh, both V and J. If I, you know, if there's a V11, V22, there's also a V12. Okay. And the simplest model of the sort that you should keep in mind is just delta function recursion. You know, could be in ballpark groups. Yeah, I didn't have charge. Great. So let's think, understand the symmetries of the system. So the Hamiltonian that I wrote, if you want, you can think of it as bosons sitting in two different layers, spatially. Think of this as one component, think of this as the other component. And the Hamiltonian conserves the number of particles of each species separately. Right? There's no tunneling between the two species. Right? So there's two global U1 symmetries, one for the conservation of N1 and one for the conservation of N2. And the total charge will be N1 plus N2. Now, in addition, there's this conserved quantity N1 minus N2. And I call that the total pseudo spin. Okay. This is just terminology, it doesn't matter. I need to call this something, so let me call it pseudo spin. And likewise, I need to call this something, so let me call it charge. And don't think about coulombic matches. Right? Now, there's two kinds of currents that can flow in the system. If both bosons go in the same direction, that's there'll be a net flow of N1 plus N2, so there'll be a charge current, a current of this charge. While if one boson goes this way and the other boson goes the opposite way, there's no transport of N1 plus N2, but there's a transport of N1 minus N2. Okay? So there's a pseudo spin current. So this is the model we'll start with. It has two U1 symmetries. Separate conservation of the two species, but later we can relax and just conservation of total boson number to have just a single U1. And because I have a magnetic field, I have broken time reverse of symmetry completely. Okay. So, you know, quantum Hall physics, one of the very fruitful ways to proceed is to write down the answer. Right? So let's try to do that. Let's try and make a guess for a possible ground state of the system. Now the interspecies recursion V12 is huge, at least comparable, if not bigger, than the same species recursion. Then what we might want to try to do with the ground state wave function is to make sure that particles of different species avoid each other. Okay? So we might think of writing down a wave function, which lives in the lowest land level and has this property that when a particle of one species approaches a particle of the other species, that the wave function vanishes. Okay? This can be built in through a factor like Zi minus Wj, which tells you that when any Zi approaches Wj, any Wj, that the wave function is zero. And Zi and W are the complex coordinates of the two boson species. These ghost in pattern is the usual things that enter the land level wave functions. Right? So we might guess that the wave function has some structure like this. Right? It'll turn out that that is essentially correct. But let's, you know, run with this guess and build in some physics.
And you somehow make
sure that it's symmetric. Yes. So the dot dot dots will have to ensure all that. Right? So let's think about this factor Zi minus Wj. So what this does, right, if I fix any single W particle and take any Z particle and go take it around the loop that encloses this W particle, then I'll pick up a phase of 2 pi, right? Which means that the particle of each species sees the particle of the other species as a vortex. Okay? So that's the physics that we are trying to build in. So if the particle of each species sees every particle of the other species as a vortex, then naturally there will be a binding, there'll be factors like Zi minus Wj, which will ensure that when particles of opposite species try to come close together, then the wave function amplitude is vanishes. Okay?
Does the relative strength of the external field and the inducting strength, the ratio of the two matter?
Right, so good, it does matter, but right, so I'm going to assume that the interaction strength is smaller than the cyclotron spacing. So then the cyclotron spacing got sort of the problem. We had that being in action. So following what a spread is standard in the quantum Hall, in studies of the quantum Hall effect, let's incorporate this physics into a mean field theory that will, give us a description of the state. And so what we'll do is to pretend that each boson of one species grabs a quantum of flux, a fictitious quantum of flux of the other species, then it's binding itself to a vortex of the other species to form a new entity. Right? And this new entity, and likewise boson of species 2, grabs a 2 pi flux as seen by the of the other species, right, of species 1, to form another new entity. Okay? So these new entities are still bosons, because they've been attached to vortices of the other kind. Right? It doesn't change their statistics itself. So these things are bosons, and some terminology you might have heard of composite bosons, the quantum Hall effect is a certain kind of composite boson, it's what they may call a neutral composite boson. So the idea behind this flux attachment is that once I do this, then filling factor nu equals 1, on average, the attached flux will cancel the external magnetic field, and these new entities will now move in zero magnetic field. Okay? This kind of story is probably familiar from the discussions of the fractional quantum Hall effect. For instance, a very fruitful way to think about the lossless one-third state in the fractional quantum Hall effect is to start with the microscopic model of electrons, right, which move in some big magnetic field, and then make up a story where you say that each electron has grabbed 3 flux quanta of the external field, attached itself to it, attached its 3 flux quanta to it, to form a new object, which you can argue is a boson, and these bosons move in zero field, and then those bosons, because they're moving in zero field, they're both condensed, and it turns out that if you work this through, that is the right description of the Laughlin fraction from Hall state. It's a simple physical way of thinking about the fraction of quantum Hall effect. How many of you have seen that story before? Okay, a good fraction of the audience. So we're going to do the same thing now, but for these two species of bosons, but now by attaching flux of the opposite species to each species. And this flux attachment, once we on average, you'll have a cancellation of the external magnetic flux, giving you bosons at zero average p. It's at least comparable. I won't show this, but it turns out we can do a numerical calculation to see what the range of stability of the phase I'm going to describe as. And if you have delta function repulsion with the same strength for interspecies and interspecies, it turns out the space is stable.
Between the species, D and W are different
species. Exactly. So if I have V12, right, even in the limit in which V12 is equal to V11 and equal to V22, numerically the space turns out to be stable. It's really a very, very we've studied it numerically for various parameters, and that's what it's a really stable phase. It's not a huge parameter. Okay, so it's possible to take the flux attachment theory and convert it into a field theory, but I'm not going to do that. Right? I want to keep the discussion elementary. Right? So if you've seen this discussion in the quantum Hall, fraction quantum Hall context, then you can repeat the exercise. Actually, this is, since all of you have seen flux attachment, this is again a good homework problem for you to convert this story of attaching opposite flux into a Chern-Simons-Landau-Ginzburg description of the state. But let me just discuss the physics in a much more elementary way. Okay. So these particles, these composite bosons, where I have attached 2 pi flux, the 2 pi vortex in other species to my first species, they are the basic particles in terms of which I'm describing the system. Now let's imagine that I run a current of say species 1 in that direction. Right? So then this particle which carries the charge of species 1 is going to move in that direction, in the y direction. But because it's dragging along 2 pi flux of species 2, when this moves in this direction, there's an induced voltage in the transverse direction. Okay? You know, flux motion induces the transverse voltage. Okay? And so the relationship is that the current in the y direction is equal to E squared over H times the voltage drop for species 2 in the x direction. Okay? And likewise, if I run a current for species 2, if I drive species 2 in that direction, so it's a y current, so there's a current of 2 in the y direction, there's a voltage drop for 1 in the x direction. Okay? So these are two basic equations that come out of the fancy theory. Okay? They're very simple if you understand. Okay? But now you can take the sum and difference of these two equations, and this immediately gives you the quantized Hall conductivity. It tells you that the electrical Hall conductivity for the total boson number is 2, while pseudo spin Hall conductivity is minus 2. Okay?
Yeah, so the reason that the bosons do not condense here is because of the strong field or strong conduction.
Right, so the microscopic bosons, the original bosons that I have, they don't condense because of the combination of strong field and strong interaction. Right? So these bosons cannot condense, both because the kinetic energy is quenched in the field and because they are interacting. Right? But now I've gone to a different set of bosons, and these fictitious composite bosons, they do condense. Right? But when they condense and they flow, because they come with attached flux, their flow leads to transverse voltages. That's how you think about the Cornell effect in this description. Normally, in a simple, if you have a Bose condensation, when you run a current, there's no voltage drop. But here, because the attached flux, there's a transverse voltage drop, so there's no longitudinal voltage drop. Yeah?
Now I'm confused because the flux attachment I know does not make the lambda level projection. Your wave function does, which is, you know, if you project, these are all the things we should the question is that, you know, on the one hand, you want to argue that they cannot condense because if you project onto the lambda level, they don't have kinetic energy. On the other hand, the simple lambda principle theory usually doesn't make use of the lambda level.
Right, at the mean field level, the mean field thing doesn't make use of the angular level projection. In the standard, say, so fraction Cornell, one third fraction Cornell state, if you want to get the right wave function, you do the Gaussian fluctuations about mean field, and that's enough to
induce the
get you just the ZM and the ZJQ without the moment. Okay. Right. So the full theory is okay. Well, you quantitative things like estimated energy gap.
I was more concerned about the mechanism for condensation of the flux attached.
Right.
Bosons, the neutral bosons.
Right.
You
know,
in order to sort of not have to worry about it, you have to have some kinetic energy.
Absolutely. That's right.
They're condensed
way. Right. So, in the old fashioned theory, you just make an exact gauge transformation.
Right.
So, we've reached our desired goal of producing an integer quantum Hall state of bosons. But we still have to check that the state doesn't have any non-trivial bulk representations. And it certainly has an integer electrical bulk representation. Okay? So let's think about edge states. Okay? So because there's an electrical quantum Hall effect, there will be a charged edge mode that goes in one direction. I always get the direction wrong. Counterclockwise. I mean, just imagine you're outside though. So there's a charged edge mode that runs in one direction, but there's a pseudo spin quantum Hall effect, right? Which means there's a pseudo spin, the counterflow mode, that's running in the opposite direction. Okay? So there's counterpropagating edge states, but only one branch transports electrical charge, the other branch is electrically neutral, but has non-zero pseudo spin. It transports N1 minus N2, while the first branch, the red branch, transports N1 plus N2. Now, apart from the electrical Hall conductivity, there's another transport quantity that is theoretically useful when characterizing any quantum Hall state. These days, people are making a heroic effort to try to measure it in experiments, Alice's his colleague at Baxman Institute has some very interesting ideas around measure that's what's known as the thermal Hall conductivity. In any quantum Hall state, it turns out it is also quantized, and it also gives you information about the topological features of this quantum Hall state, which is sometimes distinct from the topological data that's contained in the measurement of the electrical Hall conductivity. So what is the thermal Hall effect? You imagine applying a thermal gradient in one direction, and you measure the peak current in the transverse direction. So that's the Hall effect in the peak transform. And the thermal Hall conductivity in the right units, kappa xy divided by the free electron Lorentz number times temperature, is quantized to some rational number in a fractional quantum Hall state. An integer quantum Hall effect, it turns out it's the exact same, in that it's quantized to be an integer, which is exactly the same as the sigma xy. But in the fractional quantum Hall state, it can be different. A good example in standard fractional quantum Hall physics is the two-thirds state, which believed to have counterpropagating neutral modes, which will change from the Hall. So here, only this mode transports electrical charge. So that will give you a sigma xy, which we calculated to be 2 in the previous slide. But because there's a current, there's a neutral current, and one minus N2 current going in the opposite direction, both these modes transport heat, and because of that, the thermal Hall conductivity will be zero. Okay? So that's a feature of the statement we've constructed.
So how would this be different from
early on by a which fill in? Yeah, so for instance, you can ask about mu equals half plus half, like the famous quantum Hall value. So there sigma xy is 1, and kappa xy is, kappa xy is a bit tricky because there, as you know, without interlayer tunneling, there's the spontaneous interlayer coherence. So it's bulk dissipation. But if you freeze that by having some explicit tunneling, then kappa xy is also 1. But there's many states for which kappa xy is some independent number. Non-abelians, it's half in, was exactly half in. They're distinguished by one of the distinctions is thermal Hall conductivity.
Isn't it? So both these are robust even if N1 and N2 are not separately conducted?
We'll talk about that. That's really the next point that I want to make. Just do exactly the same thing you've always done. So the relevant central charge is what's known as the chiral central charge. It's the difference between the number of right movers and left movers. You have the same number of right movers and left movers, or the top movers and bottom movers. Okay. So the chiral central charge is zero, which means the thermal Hall conductivity is zero.
What if I only have one, let's say the charge one? Is it
preferring
one?
Exactly. It turns out that the state cannot exist with the conditions that I've stipulated for bosons. I need to have this counterpropagating state. I can have one-way propagating edge modes for bosons. Let me just throw the statement at you. Since you seem to know the word central charge, you probably know enough to be able to prove the statement. It turns out the only way I can have one-way propagating edge modes for the bosons without having any exotic excitations in the bulk is have a central charge of 8. Or a multiple of 8. Prove that statement. Special homework for you. actually, for anyone else in the audience, it's a cool result, right? That it has to be a multiple of 8. So Arun, since he's always asking the right questions, sometimes even before I give my talk. So what happens if we include interspecies tunneling? So then the pseudo spin is not conserved, but only the total particle number is conserved. Okay. It's easy to understand this from the end state picture. I have a N1 plus N2 current going in that direction, N1 minus N2 current going in this direction. Okay. Now if I introduce explicit tunneling, which breaks microscopically conservation of N1 minus N2, but preserves conservation of N1 plus N2, you can ask whether you can lose this edge state. But if you can't lose the edge state, because the only way you can kill this dashed edge state is for it to backscatter into the upgoing edge state. The upgoing edge state carries, you know, physical global U and total particle number, total charge. So you can't backscatter. Right? So long as N1 plus N2 conservation is preserved, there's no way to backscatter. Right? So it's protected even if I break that symmetry. So these edge modes, the kind of propagating edge modes cannot backscatter due to charge conservation. And so we see that the edge modes are preserved so long as total charge is conserved. But precisely because I have both forward propagating and backward propagating edge modes, if I break all symmetries, for instance, I break conservation of both N1 plus N2 and N1 minus N2, then there's nothing protecting these two channels from scattering into each other, right? And then I can gap out the edge. So this is an example of an edge mode in the boson system which is symmetry protected, right? Just like for a topological enslaver. Right? Unlike the interior quantum Hall effect, where you can break any of the symmetry of the system and the edge mode is totally protected, because nothing for it to scatter into, just one way going. In the topological insulator of fermions, say quantum Hall state, you have edge modes, one mode going this way, another mode going that way. And there they can't backscatter because of time reversal. But if you break time reversal, they can backscatter. And that means it's all. Here it's the same story, except that we have a boson system. Right? An interacting boson system. This is a symmetry protected topological phase of bosons. You can describe it more formally understand the essential topological aspects in some nice formulation, but let me not talk about that. So the state that I've described has sigma xy equals 2 and kappa xy equals 0. Now, clearly, we can obtain other such states by taking sigma xy equals 2 and then kappa xy equals 0 by just stacking together many copies of what I already had. But we notice that this construction, right, the model that I've constructed and the states that I've constructed this way, all of them have an integer quantum Hall effect where sigma xy is necessarily even. Okay? So is this just the lack of my imagination? Is this all I can, it's because what I've been able to do? Or is this a fundamental restriction? Okay? So it turns out that there's a fundamental restriction, and there's a very simple way to see it, and let me give that argument. Okay? Suppose I had some system of bosons that's gapped and that has a global U1 symmetry. No time reversal. It's in some quantum Hall state. Right? What I want to do is to thread in a 2π flux into the state, you know, a Laughlin-like flux threading picture. I imagine threading in 2π flux at some in some point of the sample. Now, in the bulk. Yeah, just like what Laughlin did in 1983. So Laughlin imagined humans having done in 1983. Now, as usual, when I thread in this flux, I'll induce an EMF that's, you know, circulating electric field in that direction. And because the sigma xy, then I suck in some charge. And the amount of charge that we suck in is precisely sigma xy. Like, this is Laughlin's famous argument for why there's charge one-third excitations in this one-hole state. Now, you can calculate the statistics of this particle that's created. Right? By threading in a 2π flux, when you exchange two of them, and the exchange statistics is 5 times sigma xy. And again, in the Laughlin 1/3 state, this is the reason why you have pi, you know, any onset statistics pi over sigma. But now, we've declared that we do not want to have any exotic thing in the bulk, which means there's no topological order, there's no fractional charge, fractional statistics. Now, here's a crucial point. In a boson system, not having fractional statistics means not having even fermions. Right? Fermions, you know, are not naturally created in a boson system. You perform any integer number of composites of the bosons, you only get a boson. Right? So, if your Hilbert space is that of bosons, even fermions are fractional statistics. So, it outlawed all such phenomena, which means the only excitations that I can have are boson excitations, which means the this object must be a multiple of 2 pi, and therefore sigma xy is even.
Okay?
Yeah.
If you
are
multiple copies of n, you backscatter your the coordinate space that you're using.
No, they're all going in the same direction, right? Right. Because they're all going the same direction. All the N1 minus N2 currents are going in the same direction. All the N1 plus N2 currents are going in the same opposite direction.
It's robust.
Exactly. Yeah. So this is the basic story. And the only modification, so this is all there is for bosons. The only modification is the side comment that I made to her about adding something which has Topological. That's a multiple of 8. But let me not worry about it. So this is a very simple physical example of a system of attracting bosons in two dimensions that goes into a phase which has trivial excitations in the bulk, but nevertheless has end states that are protected so long as you have a certain symmetry. If you break that symmetry, the state becomes smoothly connected to a trivial state. Okay? Yeah?
What does this phase look like in the phase diagram of fields, interspecies interaction, and intraspecies interaction? Does it survive in limits where it does go to zero or infinity?
Right, okay. So I can draw here, but people there may not be able to see. But that's probably okay. Let's take delta function in fraction. Let's take interactions in this form. So there's two parameters, dB and dS, and we can, the limit of log, that log second form frequency, we can draw a phase diagram as a function of G same over G different. Okay? Now, if G same equals G different, that's some point here, that this ratio is 1. And this phase exists in some window like that. Okay. If G same goes to infinity compared to G different, then there are two species of basically decoupled from each other. They each want to satisfy themselves first. And then I have bosons at nu equals 1. And it's known through numerical work that they form what involves states of their own. It's actually a very interesting state. It's this Scorpion state that's known to be in these patients. Right? So, in this limit, it turns out that where this boundary is, it extends to quite some distance to the phase diagram. So, here you get this Scorpion plus Scorpion. So, you have two decoupled bosonic quantum states at nu equals 1, which topologically don't talk to each other. And this limit, something else happens, which is not entirely under control numerically, but there is a natural guess. So in this limit, it should really, it's not entirely under control numerically. Probably what happens is that the space separation. Right? You know, the simplest way in which species of opposite kind can avoid each other, right, is by just space separating. Right? that's probably what happens. And then in each domain, they have a single phase. You have bosons that fill in your equals two. And that is not completely well settled in the equation. It looks like there may be a different monobillion from Hall state. So actually the space diagram is very interesting because the space that I talked about, the boson integer from Hall state, is very stable. It exists in a wide range, but it's sandwiched between two other phases, both of which are much more interesting than the space. So it's a win-win because these non-abelian states have been known for a long time. Right? Even though the state is a lot simpler, right, it's been known only for about 3 or 4 years now. And it's an SPT phase. Right? So here I have, if Eric and his colleagues ever manage to get bosons cold in a magnetic field, these interactions are not crazy interactions. Right? So, in the superopponent system, you'll see, whatever you see, it's going to be really cool and interesting. Okay? You can say, this is cool because it's new, and these are cool because they're just cool.
So all this then is just said is really cool if you just have continuum.
Yes. But, you know, once you have lattice systems, you have to do serious work. Okay? So luckily, that serious work has been done in the last couple of years. There's in fact a very nice numerical study of a model that I'm told is not unrealistic in the cold atoms context by Nigel Cooper, Nicola and York, of bosons and optical flux lattice, where in their numerics it looks like there's a very stable phase. So they have a very concrete proposal on how to realize this. So the detailed model is different. It's not just trying to mimic the continuum, but the topological state is the same. So the model by definition has a strong magnetic field. Explicitly.
Yeah.
Right? And then there's a charge conservation, there goes a number of conservation symmetry.
Yeah. But when you refer to it, it just means that you're not allowed the backscattering.
Right, and backscattering is not allowed because of charge conservation symmetry.
So what does it mean by charge conservation? So what does it mean by you want to?
Right, so imagine you have access to a giant superfluid of the bosons, right? A huge superfluid, right? Deep in the superfluid phase, and you bring that in contact. So you take your one-wall system, right? Your boson one-wall system here, and then you attach it here to a giant superfluid. So then, this giant superfluid acts like a classic, the boson creation operator becomes a classical field in this giant superfluid. Right? So then that acts as a coherent source or sink of bosons, through which bosons can tunnel out the end state. And once you have something like that, then there's no protection of these end states. Formally, in the clinical situation, formally what one means is that you add to the Hamiltonian terms like V plus V dash. Okay? You know, and then ask whether the protection is still there, and it's not. Yeah.
You always assume these V12 or V11 to be repulsive only, right?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Both of the attraction are complicated. You could study that problem too, but it's a lead you to other phenomena.
So if you were to violate N1 plus N2,
right,
but preserve the N1 minus N2,
you'll still have symmetry protection. It's stable.
So what symmetry protects this
thing? It's U1. Yeah, there's a single global U1.
But it switches between one symmetry and another.
Right, so whether you call it you know, which U1 it is, it's which U1 you choose to preserve, it's up to you. I've given you a model where I started with the U1 plus U1 symmetry, and I broke it down to a single U1 explicitly. Right? It doesn't matter which one.
In this framework, can you go beyond SVT, like there are some other inductions to get some induction?
Sure, you can certainly do that. You mean the framework being within this flux attachment type theory?
With the boson.
Yeah, for flux attachment for bosons, is that what you mean? Sure, yeah. For instance, there's a famous Laughlin state of bosons that where it was a half. Was wave function z and zb squared, level for decades. And so you can understand that, again, as people have done for decades, using the same flux attachment framework, where you attach two flux quanta with the bosons, reconvert them back into bosons at zero phi, and those composite bosons then condense, but the attached flux means an undercurrent as a transverse voltage. Yeah, so. The technology-wise, everything that I've used here is really, you know, the theoretical technology is at least 20, 25 years old, but the phenomena are new. So all this could have been worked out 20 years back, but it wasn't, because people didn't ask this question. It's only post-topological insulator that this question has come up. So I think my time is up. There's many other things that I could have said, but I'm happy to actually just stop here. So you have a glimpse of this life beyond non tracking from
once. Well, we started late, so maybe you can take
all right.
Extra 5 minutes to sort of give us what
you want. Alright, okay. Oh, I should have to make a problem. So there are two things that I wanted to talk about. One was an example of topological integration of bosons in three dimensions. And now I'm going to assume that the symmetry is a charge conservation entanglement. Okay. And after having done that, for those of you who work in solid state physics to satiate your love of electronic solids, I wanted to tell you about a result about the kinds of topological insulators that can exist in electronic solids with spin orbit coupling in three dimensions. Okay. So in band theory, there's only two distinct phases. There's the trivial insulator and the topological band insulator. But once you include interactions, it turns out there's a total of 8 phases. So there's 6 new phases that don't have any free fermion counterpart. Okay. And that is that, you know, symmetry protected topological insulator of bosons. In three dimensions. But to really appreciate where the argument for those results come from, it's sort of useful to have worked through all of this with these examples in 2D and 3D of topological insulator bosons. Let me perhaps quickly indicate what the physics of these 3D topological boson insulators are. Is that okay? Yeah. So the physics of these 3D boson topological insulators is first, there's a quantized magnetoelectric effect, just like there is for the fermionic topological insulator, which Arun mentioned in his talk recently, that there's a magnetoelectric response parameterized by an angle theta, where theta equals phi. So for bosons, it turns out the same effect exists, but the angle theta must be 2 phi, right? For reasons that I'll explain, perhaps for at least indicating in a minute. But in terms of, you know, general understanding of the physics, the essential property that makes the surface of a boson topological insulator different from the surface of an ordinary boson insulator is that, you know, the surface is a two-dimensional system. Okay? And for bosons in two dimensions, you can think about what the vortices do, the vortex in the phase of the boson, and it turns out that the important thing, feature, for boson topological insulator, then the vortices become compounds. Usually, in a two-dimensional superfluid, it's, you know, to want to think about the vortices as quantum particles, the natural statistics that you attribute to them are that the vortices are bosons. Okay? But here, on the surface of the topological insulator, the vortices become fermions. So that's the essential physics. So let me just make a few remarks on where all this comes from. Right? So what we might want to do in thinking about bosonic topological insulators is to search for an analog of this odd number of narrow cones that characterizes the fermionic topological insulator. Right? What is the analogous theory for the surface of a bosonic topological insulator? And the key requirement of any curative theory of the surface of a bosonic TI is that I cannot have a trivial state at the surface. This is the analog of saying that my surface and the edge state of a 2D SPT phase cannot be trivially gapped out. In three dimensions, the analogous statement is to say the surface cannot be in a totally trivial phase, right, while preserving all symmetries. So the question then is how should one implement this feature that a trivial symmetry preserving insulator is not possible? So the really protective physical way of thinking about what happens is to think about this in terms of vortices. In three dimensions, if I have a not an insulator but a superfluid phase in three dimensions with a vortex lines, right? And one way to kill the superfluid is to proliferate vortex lines. You can do that thermally and get a thermal phase transition, but quantum mechanically, if you want to get a boson insulator, then what you're It's useful to think about the boson insulator as emerging from the superfluid by proliferating vortex, quantum loops of vortices. Okay? But if you don't want to describe the bulk but just want to describe the surface, you can think about the points of penetration of the bulk vortex lines at the surface. Okay? And let's just think about the surface and ask what happens to these points where the bulk vortex line has penetrated the surface. Okay? And it turns out that thinking in terms of the vortices is really powerful because there is this feature of two-dimensional bosonic systems that we can describe them